I just introduced my partner Michael Mansfield, who himself he submitted some evidence.
Yeah, it's on an email form, very short. Yeah. Whether you've got it.
Because I think it's...
You have to speak up a bit, because I'm a bit deaf.
Oh, right, okay, sorry. Well, I was just introducing Michael. He has submitted some evidence himself as to how it impacts, well, impacts me, but impacts him as well.
Yes,
because
right.
Obviously it's not just an immediate impact on the patient, it's far-reaching for people that have to look after you, that have to live with what is happening. That can be very, very difficult, very trying and tiring for people. So Michael is my support mechanism, keeps me sane. My name is Yvette Greenway. And I lead a patient support group called Mashed Up by Mesh. It's only a small group, and I only founded it earlier this year, purely because of my own experiences with Mesh. I'm also a joint CEO of a mental health charity called SOS Silence of Suicide, which has provided some data for us, which I'll refer to later. And I also campaign on issues apart from vaginal Mesh. I'd like to thank the Baroness and the rest of the review team for giving the patient groups a voice in these reviews. We hope that those representing medical professions will follow our example by offering honest and accurate evidence. I'd like to acknowledge the determined campaigning done by so many individuals and groups over so many years. Many of these ladies are firm friends, and it's through their persistence and their voices that I believe we're here today with this review taking place. Many work quietly and effectively behind the scenes, despite their own serious ill health, in order to provide an information highway from which all Messenger patients can benefit. I'd like also to remember those who've died because of Mesh complications, and those that are struggling at home today, unable to do very much at all. For Mesh-injured women, today is a day we'd never have envisaged. Not in our worst nightmares could we have imagined we'd be fighting for justice and accountability, laying bare the most personal and private highways of our minds and our bodies. Purely through being implanted with a permanent medical device made from a material known to be unstable and liable to changes whilst inside the body, and which is subjected to little or no clinical testing, which will change our bodies and the way we live forever, and not in the positive manner we were all told prior to surgery. And we seemingly have no potential for stability or improvement to be achieved. Figures compiled for Panorama by NHS Digital and NHS Wales show the NHS has implanted more than 130,000 Mesh devices in the last decade alone. In that same period, there have been 6,000 procedures to remove or partially remove the implants. It's acknowledged the real figure could be much higher. These figures only relate to NHS in England and Wales, do not include women who have paid to have the device removed privately, or those who have a small amount of Mesh removed. We must all believe that through the review process, robust recommendations, including a complete ban on vaginal Mesh, regardless of why it was implanted, are achieved. As patients, we allow the medical profession access to our bodies, our thoughts, and our lifestyles, all manner of information to better assist them in reaching decisions about the best course of treatment for us. We, the patients, deserve the same. We should be aware of clinicians' allegiances or involvements, whether they be financial or other, so that we too can reach informed decisions about who is best to treat us and how it should treat us. I'm just going to briefly read some information about myself and my own experience of Mesh. I'd just like to confirm I have no commercial, financial, legal connection or interest in the pharmaceutical and medical devices industry sector or any other body or organisation of interest to the review. Now, I'm just going to go on to some of the points that have been raised by people that I deal with in the patient group Mashed Up by Mesh. I did keep it brief, and I've got quite a bit of evidence which I'm going to try and read out to you from some of these people, but there is quite a lot of it, so I'll have to read. What time did I start? Was it about 5?
Started about 5 past.
Right, okay, thank you, okay. Okay, so Mashed Up by Mesh is a patient group that supports mesh-affected individuals and was set up earlier this year by myself. The document that I sent to the review team contains summarised and anonymised information from mesh-injured women, which we want to form part of our submission, alongside the mental health survey from SOS Silence of Suicide, and I'll come to the mental health aspect soon. So I've summarised briefly. Frequent comments from mesh injured patients include the extent of the physical damage caused by their mesh implants, for example, vaginal and lower abdominal pain, bleeding, back pain, leg pain, chronic infections, exhaustion and nausea. And those basically seem to be repeated throughout the mesh community. The impact that physical issues have on their family life, their social life, and their work life. Obviously, there are people that cannot go to work anymore because their injuries do not allow them to do so. A lot of people are relying on children and or partners, if they have them, to help support them with tasks that they would normally and traditionally do, but simply need assistance with that, or they need the task done for them because they can't do it at all. Something I've already mentioned, the indifference that mesh patients are subjected to by GPs and consultants, many of whom do not even consider the patient's mesh history, and if they do, they feel it's not responsible for their current problems. One thing we're hearing a lot, especially in women of a certain age, is that they are told that their symptoms are probably due to their menopause. That is being repeated over and over again. Now, it sort of implies a distinct apathy within the profession that they would think that. And in my case, when I was told that, I had gone through menopause when I had my hysterectomy in 2009. I've never had any bleeding since I'd gone through the menopause. And all of a sudden, it started last year with pain. But I was told that menopause can be a funny thing and things can happen at any time. Quite frankly, I'm not a doctor, I hold my hands up, but I don't believe it. There are huge concerns over what other physical issues could be caused by mesh and its compounds going forward. It's known that polypropylene resin contains an ingredient which can help trigger cancer. So that there is lots out there. I think we're all aware it's quite easy to look it up on the internet, online. But there are concerns because whilst women are where they are now in relation to the physical damage, there is also a huge concern. Well, what other things are awaiting just around the corner? Can this be responsible for things that we actually don't know about yet? Maybe some people do, but are we going to get to hear about it? When will we get to hear about it? Maybe when it's too late, we'll be told about it. So we are trying to prevent that situation. So we're very keen to know, if there has been research done and if any other, if there is a likelihood, no matter how small, that polypropylene resin could be responsible going forward for other illnesses that may develop within our bodies. The lack of qualified and competent surgeons who can carry out full removals. There seems to be about a handful, literally a handful, of surgeons who profess to having the capabilities and the experience to remove mesh. I don't think anyone can be fully experienced as of yet, because the problem only really seems to be gathering pace and people are demanding that they have removals now. However, does there not need to be some kind of funding for training of these consultants to ensure they know exactly what they are doing, and actually to manage patient expectation? Because I've been told, for example, it'd be impossible to remove the whole of mine completely because of the hooks on the side, yeah? So I've been told it'd be impossible. But some patients are being told it's possible to have a full removal, only to be told upon consultation, no, sorry, actually, it's not. So I think there needs to be patient expectation management. And we need a list of surgeons that have done mesh removal, full mesh removal, and we need that information displayed publicly so patients can go and think, okay, how many operations, removals has that person done? You know, how recently have they done it? What's their background, etc., etc. And then again, it passes the control back to the patient to make an informed choice, which is something that's been lacking, completely lacking. Okay, there's little and completely insufficient understanding and support of the psychological harm endured by mesh-affected patients. Again, I'll go through that in more detail shortly. There are thoughts of suicide and self-harm. There are instances of self-harm and suicide attempts. There is a complete lack of confidence by mesh-injured women in the medical profession. Women are concerned about any attempt at removal surgery. It is not always possible to completely remove the mesh. Therefore, the question they're asking is, are they meant to live the whole of their lives in pain and despair? And that's a really good point, actually, because even if someone manages to get the whole of the mesh removed, what does that mean in terms of pain for the rest of our lives? And if it can't be removed, knowing that this mesh creates a reaction anyway, which is ongoing within the body. What does that mean for us? That we just have to, we live with it forever? Forever? That's a long time. I've been told, and again, I haven't substantiated this, so I'm just telling you what I've been told. A lady apparently lost her womb after enduring severe bleeding following mesh implant surgery. There is a feeling that mesh-affected patients have been used as guinea pigs in the absence because there wasn't necessarily any need for thorough trialing. Anger that medical devices can so easily slip onto the market. Anger at the lack of information and transparency. Anger there is no mandatory recording of interest held by members of the medical profession with product manufacturers and suppliers. Sadness that some lives have been irrevocably changed for the worst. Disbelief that mesh has continued to be used for so long, despite problems reported by patients, and these problems and reports apparently being ignored. Anger and sadness at the loss of life due to mesh complications, and worry about finances, especially if some people have had to give up work, and also people have been trying to claim PIP, personal independence payment, which I think we are fully entitled to varying degrees, granted. But if anyone knows about the process, it is an absolute nightmare. Basically, it is designed not to give you anything. That's how it is designed. That additional stress for women that have got physical and psychological problems anyway, and then they are told, no, they can't get this benefit, which they are fully entitled to. That is the least that they're entitled to. So I do think that needs to be looked at. I think, Julia, I've actually mentioned somewhere that I think PIP should be granted to mesh-injured patients where it is confirmed in writing by clinicians. I think there should be an automatic granting of PIP. Okay.
So do you want... Michael to come in now.
Yes, would you like to say if you want to
before? No, I'll be very brief because I'm sure you've heard this before. I just want to pick out what I think are, for me anyway, coming relatively new to this whole dilemma and catastrophe, really. First point is, and Yvette's made a lot of very good points, I don't repeat one, just the main one, the true lack of research in the first place. Before this was implanted, that is then entails, it seems to me, a complete lack of monitoring, having put it in, to see how it develops with them. Thirdly, which Yvette just mentioned from her group, And I've been to every attendance of the medical authorities. The third thing is, there is no clear information or advice as to what to do. Do you have a bit of it removed? Well, the surgeon who was about to do it, fixed an operation, I was there when he fixed it, in the end said that he was only capable of doing a partial removal, and in any event, there were no guarantees it would make any difference. Now you move to a full removal, it's the same problem. There is no one who is able to say, even if you have it all removed, that this will solve the problem, because there will be, I think after that, knock-on effects in other parts of the abdomen, which might involve infection. Having removed something that's grown into the tissue, something else has got to fill its space. Plus, it doesn't solve bladder problems and all the other things that you've heard about. So this is a nightmare situation, a dystopia in which people are completely trapped. You don't know where to go. And that adds to all the other symptoms of fatigue is one of those where, you know, it's impossible to measure it, but on a daily basis, you're just totally exhausted most of the time, on top of worrying about what is going to happen. So those would be my main points just to follow on. And I have to say, I was utterly appalled, because I was present at the consultation. There was an air of nonchalance by this consultant, arrogance, and the thing that's concerned me most in the whole of this, and why I got more than anxious and I've come to everything, is the never mind the fatigue, incessant bleeding. Now for me, any internal bleeding is a symptom and a sign of something that is seriously wrong. The body doesn't automatically do that. Therefore, once you've got bleeding on a daily basis, and it's not, sometimes it's little, sometimes it's a lot, every day the body is losing blood, that's got to be an extremely serious situation. But this consultant, and there I was witnessing exactly what Yvette has described, is actually treating her as though, well, you know, women may have these periods in their lives when, and he compared it almost to some sort of menstrual discharge. I couldn't believe it. And this was his assessment. Actually, don't worry about it. And he was ready for the next patient. And I have to say, well, you probably know what I do. If I treated someone like that, I would feel I was not discharging my obligations and I wasn't at a caring profession.
Did you point it out? Sorry to interrupt.
No, well, we did. And I'll be honest. No, we didn't. I think we were both shocked. We both got outside and went in the car. And we looked at each other and thought, what is this? And so
I did go back to my GP and I said, I have no idea why you sent me to see this man. And I told her exactly what happened, and she was shocked, but he was recommended. I said, well, I don't know who he was recommended by and I don't really care, as I'm telling you now, but I will not be going back there. I have no desire. And I told her exactly what happened. Yeah. But it was an absolute shock. It's like, because this man who was talking like this, actually he deserved, on behalf of all women that are mesh injured, he deserved to be stood in front of them all and let them all.
And I think it's a very good point you make, because I'm used to asking questions all the time. But actually I suddenly experience what a lot of people tell me, which is, you're in the presence of an expert. He's supposed to be one of the leading authorities in the United Kingdom in this area. And you have to reflect, and so you're mildly humble about it all. I think, well, maybe he knows more than we do. Maybe there's something we're missing here. And the full impact of the way he's treated you doesn't really impact itself at the time until actually moments later. And then you think, we've just been through what everybody talks about. And so the complaint came later. But and so I now fully understand how women experience this really dismissive. It's what it is. It's a dismissive attitude.
Can I just say, I mean, we've heard similar stories across the country, I'm afraid. And we are going to be interviewing surgeons, of course, and surgeons who actually have taken out mesh which we think is very important.
Yes.
But I suspect, and we don't know, we have to hear from them, but we've had some informal conversations, and I suspect they will say every case is different, every woman is different, everybody is different. But so to actually come out with a directive, this is what you should do, it does depend on the person, on the individual patient. So I suspect that is, but you need to know the risks. And I think your issues on consent are just, again, we've heard a lot about that. And I have to say, it is shattering. I mean, it is awful that these things happen without proper informed knowledge that is given.
Precisely.
Can I just ask you one question, Yvette? You're obviously a great campaigner. I think it's in your DNA. And when I see what you've done for suicides and things like that, can I just ask you, you started your organisation quite, well, this year.
Yes.
In March, I think. Something.
Yes, it was. I can't remember exactly what month, but earlier this year. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Can I ask you what stimulated that? Because there are many other organisations, as you well know, that are dealing with MeSH.
Yes.
And I wonder why you felt it was important to introduce another one.
Sure, okay. Well, I don't think there can ever be too many, and number one, that's a simple answer. I do work very closely now with Candy McCulloch, who I believe is giving evidence next from the MeSH UK charity, and a lot of the people that she knows.
Very much agree with you. I think you can have lots of different organisations, and they all bring something a bit different.
Well, this is it. And I think we all try and look for different threads of information that we can post that hopefully will help people. So that's the idea. It's sort of creating an information base, or as many information bases as possible. And, you know, every group does its own bit. Every group brings something to the table. And some groups suit some people, and other groups suit others. So that's...
We're going to have to close in a minute, I'm afraid, because we've got another group coming in.
Okay, yes.
I'm just going to ask my colleagues if they would like to put a question to you. Anything they want to explore, or is there anything further you want to say?
Okay, the mental health, we have had more replies, Julia, so what I have to do is send you that through on email, if I may, and I'll copy you and Val on it. And I just wanted to, could I just express my support for a lady that I'm going to refer to as I believe some of you may well be aware of her case. She is a seriously MeSH injured lady, and she is. She won her case for damages from a NHS trust, and they then decided to question her testimony. It's probably the best way to put it. So they decided to film her covertly. They have decided that from filming her covertly, they believe that she has possibly exaggerated her symptoms. Now, I spent most of last night with this lady who was actually and feeling that she has gone. And she has got a new legal team in place that are helping her. She is being dealt with very harshly. So I think it's important we think about her today because she's been treated disgustingly. My concern here is the NHS Trust, in my opinion, I've seen all the paperwork, all the documents, have other legal friends. Okay? There appears to be no valid reason for this and it has no substance. She's being put through the mill, put through the grinder, made to feel like a nobody, like a liar, which she is not. Just because an NHS trust thinks that, well, what do they think actually? You know, is this how they're going to treat all of us if we pursue claims for damages against them? Is this what they're going to do? Detract from the real issue here, which is their negligence a lot of the time, their use of products that should never have gone anywhere near the human body. So to detract from that, they start focusing on the patients and trying to sort of dismiss and belittle them and sort of diminish the integrity of that person. And this is what concerns me. I kind of wonder if this is sort of going to set a precedent here. So that is a real concern going forward. There is just so much to say. There is so much evidence here. I do have some really good questions.
That's the easiest thing to do.
Yeah, it is.
Leave the document, it's the one on the phone.
Yeah, okay.
Just leave it.
Okay, so I'll be really quick. Okay, so were the long and short term effects of plastic mesh components implanted into the human body ever measured by pharmaceutical companies, regulatory authorities, clinicians, etc., anybody? If not, was there a requirement for this to have been done? If there wasn't a requirement, why wasn't there a requirement? If it has been done, what were the manufacturer's findings, and did they share these findings with the medical profession, with clinicians? Because there are some reports that manufacturers such as, but not limited to, Johnson & Johnson may have made the medical profession aware of certain findings, but there are equally other reports of the medical profession saying that they weren't aware of any problems. So I'd like to know sort of which way around is it. I did write to the MHRA, and Julie, you've already had this as evidence some months ago, and they refused. They said that we're exempt under the Freedom of Information Act from responding to certain questions when I asked about clinical trials and the evidence that presented, the conclusions that those answers presented. So I think we should know how many consultants, NHS and private, have any form of interest or association whatsoever with manufacturers of mesh products. Is it known if there were more, less, or no real difference in the number of patients referred for mesh implants through the NHS as opposed to private referrals? Something that has cropped up quite a bit, and I think this is an important point. How many meshes have been inserted at the same time as hysterectomies have been carried out? Because I'm aware of a couple of patients who said to me that they have very, very mild incontinence symptoms and actually have no understanding as to why they needed mesh in the first place. I mean, is there a bonus upon a consultant reaching so many implants they get a golden handshake or something? I don't know, but this is how it's appearing. I've mentioned about PIP, Julia, to you. Were any studies conducted into mesh device failure once it was implanted? What were these? What were the outcomes? If these studies took place, by whom were they conducted? By whom were they requested? And with whom were the results shared? And also, who has monitored women with mesh implants? I think we all know the answer to this, that basically hasn't really been anything done. But has any monitoring been done of women that have mesh implants across the board? I don't just mean NHS. That'd be quite interesting. If data is available, what percentage of consultants have been advising women to have mesh implants and not discussing other options that may have been available to them? For example, pessaries using their own human tissue. And basically that ties in, for what reason did the medical profession choose to start recommending the use of mesh over any other methods or options that may be available? And what evidential data did they use prior to deciding to use the mesh as opposed to anything else? I'll be really quick on racing. Did any regulatory body, NHS consultant, GP, ever ask how mesh would be removed if this was necessary? And indeed, how easy would this be to achieve, and was it possible? Did anyone ever study the impact upon mesh patients should device issues occur, i.e. inflammation, erosion, bleeding, pain? What steps have been taken since the vaginal prolapse mesh ban by NICE in 2017 and subsequent temporary ban earlier this year to ensure surgeons are being trained to remove this implant? Given that removing mesh is like trying to get chewing gum out of hair, and women are being told it isn't always possible to remove, what will happen to us? Are we meant to live like this forever? Are studies being conducted now that can help working towards alleviating some of our problems? will our problems we face now increase and worsen as time goes on? The mesh remains in our bodies, and of course, we age.
I'm sorry, I haven't been able to take in all these questions. Can I suggest that you send them to us?
Yeah,
because
sure,
they are very important.
Yeah,
and
sure,
they are going to help us when we interview the regulators and various other people.
We could leave this document now.
Please do, but I think we've got these questions, most of the questions you've just asked were in your written submission, which is very helpful.
Other things that I'll type up in a summary form.
Please give us.
Is it going to be a transcript of what you said, or how's that going to work?
Yes, there is going to be a transcript.
There will be a transcript ultimately. What our plans are is to, as I say, video record all of these sessions, and the video recordings will go up on the website in due course, and before the report is published, there will be transcripts, and our intention is to make those available. With suitable reductions, and redactions obviously where we may have to, but then you will understand that.
Can I thank you both so much for coming? It's really helpful. And I'm just so, so sorry of all that you're going through and are going through. And you're quite right with your questions. It's what has happened, what is happening now, and what can we do in the future to prevent further terrible things like this happening.